When I heard rumors of AMD releasing a 16-core 32-thread CPU on mainstream desktop, I just didn't believe it, because it sounded too good to be true. But when we started seeing more confirmations of them releasing this CPU, I thought that even if it was possible, we wouldn't be seeing high enough clocks or single-threaded performance, or something somewhere will hold it back from performing well in workloads like gaming. But now, after experiencing the excellence of the CPU that we'll be taking a look at today, the impossible has become a reality. And I don't use that sentence lightly. Hey guys, I am Siddharth, and this is AMD Ryzen 9 3950X review. This year has been a big win for AMD. Thanks to their new 7nm Zen 2 architecture, they can offer better performance in a variety of workloads along with great efficiency and thermals. AMD has delivered to their promise of continuing to support the AM4 socket, and even with this major microarchitecture change, even an older B450 motherboard can be used even to handle the higher-end Ryzen 3000 CPUs. Although, you won't be able to get the PCIe 4.0 support with them. The specifications on the 3950X are something you really wouldn't have expected to be real even a year ago. This is a 16-core 32-thread part as a mainstream desktop CPU with a massive 64MB cache which still manages to keep the same TDP as its 12-core sibling. The PCIe 4.0 support means that even with 20 PCIe lanes, you'll have enough bandwidth to handle a lot of PCIe storage and expansion devices, and unless you are doing some really high-end workstation-grade stuff, you really shouldn't find this mainstream desktop platform to be limiting. We are going to be comparing between a 9900K, 3900X, and if you are wondering why I have a $2000 32-core HEDT beast of a processor in this comparison, it's because these are all the CPUs I have, and I don't want to not include the 3970X. I am aware that Intel has a new 9900KS, but that is almost the same CPU as 9900K. Our test systems for mainstream CPUs are going to be almost identical, and we'll be using a 360mm radiator to cool these CPUs, but the 3970X will be on a 240mm radiator, and you can watch its review for more details on this. All of this testing is going to be on stock CPU and memory settings, without any game modes turned on. And my 9900K really doesn't like going over 4.7 GHz, so I wouldn't have been able to overclock that anyways. In Cinebench, we see the 3950X scoring a number that has been reserved for HEDT class of CPUs. And while it doesn't look that big of a deal in front of 3970X, it really is something which you wouldn't have been able to find on a mainstream desktop CPU. The single-core Cinebench test really surprised me, as the 3950X beat both the lower and higher core count CPUs, but all this comparison shows is how excellent Zen 2 has been performing for single-core workloads, as we see an almost matching performance regardless of how many cores we have. And even the 32-core 3970X is able to match the performance of 9900K, which hasn't traditionally been the case in Intel versus AMD comparisons. In POV Ray, we see the Ryzen CPUs scaling very well, but not perfectly. But this bar graph really doesn't look good for Intel's best consumer platform CPU. POV Ray single thread is still a close comparison for all these CPUs, but that is a good thing. V-Ray is able to make a really good use of multiple cores, so we see unsurprisingly proportionate increase in performance here. Blender workloads are one of the most relevant tests for CPUs, and the 3950X really cuts down the time for both the classroom and the car render. This is a really great value option if you need to work a lot in Blender. Adobe Premiere Pro Video Render is another very important workload, which hasn't favored Ryzen CPUs in the earlier generations. But here, we see the 9900K getting beaten, and we may have seen bigger differences if we tested this with 32GB RAM. Handbrake video conversion doesn't seem to be able to take advantage of multiple cores, so here we don't see a big difference between these CPUs. 7-zip compression was another benchmark with some interesting and unexpected results, but in the decompression test, the 3950X was fully able to show its potential, and we see really great results delivered by its 32 threads. Testing the 3950X for gaming was a really pleasant surprise, as it was able to outperform even the 9900K on multiple occasions, even if the difference may have been within the margin of error. In Assassin's Creed Odyssey, we see a slight advantage for the blue team, even though the HEDT Ryzen somehow managed to almost match it. CSGO results again show some difference between the 9900K and the mainstream Ryzens, but the FPS is much more than what the monitors with highest refresh rates can offer. Shadow of the Tomb Raider also favors Intel CPUs if you are going to play at Full HD, and that too on medium settings. Ashes of the Singularity CPU-focused benchmark demonstrates the most dramatic difference between the 3950X and 9900K, while in the GPU benchmark, the 3970X seems to forget that it's a workstation-grade CPU, outperforming the 9900K. Power consumption comparison gives us a very surprising result, where the 3950X takes up less power than the 3900X, which has less number of cores. And this can be very confusing and make you check your numbers multiple times, but then when you check the voltages in HW monitor, you will find that the 3950X is actually able to run at a lower voltage than 3900X, which is a result of better binning of silicon, which can manage to stay stable at lower voltages. We didn't try undervolting the 3900X, but an average sample of 3950X should definitely be able to run normally on lower voltages. So the thermal results were also not surprising for me, because the 3950X runs cooler than the 12-core 3900X, and the 9900K shows very embarrassing results in comparison, crossing 90 Celsius, even though both of them used a 360mm radiator for cooling. We have a shorter cooler for 3970X, but again, you can watch its review for more details. So overall, the 3950X is so good that it almost doesn't make sense. You have a 16-core CPU that excels in single-threaded workloads. It is as good of a gaming CPU that you will practically need, and it runs cooler and consumes less power than the 3900X. And you can use it on previous generation AM4 motherboards. There really aren't any downsides to this processor, and I don't think that we have seen something that has been as exciting as this CPU in a long time. AMD is really killing it with their Zen 2 architecture, and they really don't seem to have plans to slow down. The 3950X is basically an HEDT processor on a mainstream consumer platform, and you even have ECC memory support and the PCIe bandwidth that you will need even for some high-end applications. So at the price of $750, we are seeing an increase in the price of top-level CPUs on the mainstream platform. But for something that is as special as this, I do think that it is totally worth it, if you can make use of the extra cores that this CPU has. Having a use for the extra cores will be a very important question when it comes to deciding which CPU you should be going for. Because if you have deep pockets, it is easy to be tempted by the technical impressiveness of this CPU. But the great thing about AMD's Ryzen 3 lineup is that you don't have to get the highest end chips to get an amazing desktop experience. For gaming, you can easily go with a Ryzen 7 3700X, which is also an 8-core CPU that is available at a really great price. The 3900X is also great for the prosumers who work and play on their computers. But if you have a use case for it, the 3950X is in a league of its own. And even though AMD does have a 32-core monster Threadripper 3970X that I reviewed recently, from the perspective of an enthusiast, the 3950X really provides a value that we have not seen on a desktop CPU. AMD has changed the rules of the game, and Intel will need something really special to be able to make a comeback against the Ryzen 3000 and the future Ryzen series. And even after they succeed with their upcoming 10 or 7 nanometer process, I don't think that the battle is going to be easy for them. So do check out my Ryzen 3900X build, which I upgraded to a 3950X, and also don't miss this very special Threadripper 3970X compact PC that was quite challenging to complete. Let me know what you think about the 3950X in the comment section below, and I'll also have links in the description if you want to buy it or check the current prices. So thanks for watching. Give this video a thumbs up if you liked it, or a thumbs down if you disliked it. Subscribe with bell for more awesome videos on tech, and I'll see you in the next one.